Hear now the word of God. As it is written in the second letter of Paul to the followers of Christ in Corinth, chapter 9, verses 6 to 11. Paul writes, "The point is this. The one who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And the one who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each of you must give as you have made up your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to provide you with every blessing in abundance, so that by always having enough of everything, you may share abundantly in every good work. As it is written, he scatters abroad, he gives to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way for your great generosity, which will produce thanksgiving to God through us." This is the word of God for all the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
In 1995, clinical psychologist Timothy Miller published a book with an intriguing title. It was called How to Want What You Have. In a society that declares that what really matters most is to have what you want, Dr. Miller's title is arresting. Why, he wants to know, is it so hard for us to believe that we already have enough? Why do we spend so much time and energy striving for more? Why do so many of us seem to believe, ironically, that while of course money doesn't buy happiness, but if we had just a little bit more money, or a little bit more time, or a little bit more pleasure, if we had just a little bit more, we would be just a little bit happier and a little bit more generous. What is at the root of this seemingly insatiable desire for more? Well, the thesis of Dr. Miller's book is as intriguing as its title, and it might sound far-fetched or controversial or even downright offensive to you, but here it is. Dr. Miller believes, based on data gathered by biologists and psychologists, that the desire for more is part of our evolutionary inheritance. That is, among our ancient human ancestors, those who accumulated more than others, they had more food, they had more territory, they were the ones who, because of their health and because of their status, were most likely to gain mates and successfully reproduce. Thus, the genes of those motivated accumulators spread most widely through the population. We then are, in some distant and profound sense, he says, their biological descendants. So according to Miller, our perpetual, seemingly insatiable desire for more is an instinct. And by that he means it is a motivation, the source of which we are usually completely unaware, that we simply take for granted, that is built into us as part of our human nature. Now, we could talk for hours about evolutionary psychology, and I'd love to do that. I am fascinated by the way that psychological insights can inform our thinking about and the living of our Christian lives. But the evolutionary theory itself, and you are, of course, free to take it or leave it, the theory itself is not the good news I am here to preach this morning. The good news that we hear in Paul's words to the Corinthians and in the theme chosen for this stewardship season is that instinct is not destiny. Generosity, that welcome and necessary antidote to our insatiable desire for more, generosity can be cultivated. We can, as Miller declares in his title and Paul assures the Corinthians, learn to want and even to rejoice in what we already have. We can, with God's help, develop a deep sense of satisfaction in the abundance that is already around us. And thus, we can become people who willingly, even cheerfully, open our hands to share our resources with others. For me, and I hope for you, that is wonderfully liberating, motivating, and even inspiring good news. So where do we start in this process of cultivating generosity? For me, the first step is simply to acknowledge that accumulating feels easier, somehow more natural, than letting go, than giving things away. Having just retired, I now have a home office that is full of books and papers accumulated over 22 years of teaching. The accumulation part was really, really easy. I didn't even notice myself doing it. Can you relate to that? Where did all this stuff come from feeling? But now, agonizing decisions. I know I have to weed things out, but what if I need those books tomorrow or next year? What if the knowledge already in my head is not enough to equip me for the unknown tasks that lie ahead? Maybe teaching, maybe preaching, who knows, right? What if what I already have is not enough? And while the accumulation of knowledge or books may not be your thing, we all have accumulation issues and anxieties about letting go. What if the money we have is not enough? What if I don't have enough time to complete all the tasks I've taken on, to prioritize my relationships, to relax and enjoy the gift of each day? What if there is not enough? So step one for me in cultivating generosity is simply to acknowledge that letting go is hard, that it sometimes makes me anxious. It is helpful too for me to recognize that the fact that it's hard for me doesn't make me unique, doesn't make me special, doesn't make me some kind of super sinner, though I may well still want to admit my anxiety to God. No, I'm just a human being like all of us here. So if you struggle to let go of stuff, to share your money or your time, I get it. We all get it. For whatever reason, evolutionary or otherwise, it's hard for us too. But the challenge doesn't need to defeat us. Most of us, despite our anxieties, really want to be free of that anxious grasping. We know it has not served us, has not served our neighbors, certainly has not served our planet very well. Yes, we want to be satisfied with what we already have, to be liberated to let go and to share. We want to participate in God's good work in the world. We want to contribute to nurturing our children's spirits, to welcoming the stranger, to feeding the hungry and housing the homeless, to seeking justice for people and the planet. So we do have a motivation that directly addresses those unconscious impulses, those seemingly insatiable desires and haunting anxieties. We can say no. Even if it is my instinct, accumulating more and 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 more is not my goal. I want instead to participate in doing God's good work in the world. So that's step two. Having acknowledged that it may be hard, we can simply choose to focus on that higher goal. We can make a conscious choice to cultivate generosity. And as Christians, we can make that admittedly hard choice with confidence and even joy because we know that God is with us, doing for us what we have so desperately, so instinctively been scrambling to do by and for ourselves. God has provided us with all that we need and more. So step three, hear the good news. Let it sink in. I think I will even memorize it and repeat it to myself whenever that anxiety about not having enough grips me. Paul, having asked the members of the church in Corinth to contribute to an offering for the poor in Jerusalem, encourages the Corinthian Christians not to be anxious. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8. I really want to memorize this. God is able to provide you with every blessing in abundance. God is able to provide you with every blessing in abundance. Every blessing, abundance. That is music to our human ears. And if you're finding it hard to hear that music, if you aren't sure you can quite believe that God can provide you with all that you need and more, again, you are not alone. But you are invited to challenge that skepticism, to test it in the real world by looking within and around you. You can even make it a game, a kind of treasure hunt to see how many blessings you can find beneath the seemingly ordinary surface of your life. Step four in cultivating generosity, make it a practice to notice God's blessings. Yes, notice the money and time you already have. We're all spending both every single day. Notice the clothes and the shelter. But there is so much more that is easy to take for granted or just to overlook. What about that warm exchange with a stranger as you quote unquote wasted time waiting in line? What about that bird song? What about that once every 10 to 20 year super blue moon? Did you notice how bright it was? What about that family member, that old or potential new friend sitting next to you in the pew this morning? What about the time to be here at all? In the sanctuary or online? What about the energy, the breath of life itself, and the freedom to decide how to use it? The goal of noticing God's blessings is not to ignore hardship. It is not to feign enthusiasm. We don't need to be fake about this. But simply to allow ourselves to register, to notice the riches we already have. For gratitude is at the heart of stewardship. What is stewardship? Yes, it is taking good care of God's creation. It is also simply the recognition that all that we have comes from God, and the desire in gratitude to share our abundance with others. Stewardship is our way of participating in the good that God longs to do in the world. And that, according to Paul, is the privilege that belongs to those of us who recognize the richness of our resources. Again, chapter 9, verse 8. And God is able to provide you with every blessing in abundance, so that by always having enough of everything, you may share abundantly in every good work. We are here on earth not to accumulate more and more money or time or even books, but to use our money, our time, our books, and our knowledge to participate in God's good work in the world. And if we stop to notice, we will acknowledge with gratitude that we have already been given enough, more than enough resources to participate fully. So step 5, trusting God to provide. Just do it. Practice generosity. Why? Well, actually, it's the practice itself that really shapes our spirits and our lives. Ultimately, we cultivate attitudes, all kinds of attitudes, but we certainly cultivate an attitude, a spirit of generosity by being generous. Yes, we may first acknowledge that generosity may not be our first instinct or even our strongest one. We can then choose to make the cultivation of generosity a goal. We can let the good news of God's generosity really sink in. And then we can notice and give thanks for God's blessings as the source of our generosity. But ultimately, the goal is just to do it. And if you find yourself experiencing obstacles to giving, again, you are not alone. A common obstacle for many of us is to become tied up in how much to give. What do you think is expected, right? How much is too little? How much is too much? Paul addressed that concern because it was one that was shared by the Corinthian Christians. Paul wrote, "Each of you must give as you have made up your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver." So put it aside and just focus on giving cheerfully. Practice generosity. And as you do, you will discover that each time you do it, giving begins to feel a little bit more natural, almost like a God-given instinct, and one that, according to Paul the Apostle, quote, will enrich you in every way and will produce even more thanksgiving to God. Our gratitude to God will increase as we realize, after sharing, how much we still have. And from those who receive what we have given, whose lives are made better because of our gifts, even more gratitude to God. Practicing generosity leads to blessings in abundance. And one of those blessings is this: we who give will become ever more generous. We will be cultivating generous spirits. Timothy Miller's title encourages us to learn to want what we have. His book offers a theory that he hopes will help us to understand the roots of our seemingly insatiable desire for more. And it also offers strategies that he hopes will help us learn to be satisfied with having enough. But Paul, in his words to the Corinthians, encourages something even more radical than that. Paul says, you not only have enough, you have blessings in abundance. You can afford to go beyond wanting, being satisfied with what you already have. Instead, you can even share it. Give some of it away. Offer a portion of your abundance to those who have less than you do. Use it to do God's good work in the world. So for us who are Christian, there is one more welcome step. We can join in giving thanks to God for the opportunity to cultivate generosity.